So basically, this talk is about volunteering local and. It's about volunteering at the local level and about helping local campaigns. It's basic. The focus is on campaigns, but I think that the principles can also apply to grassroots movements and other form of local activism. So my experience is in campaign work, so I'll probably be speaking more to campaigns, but you can take the lessons and apply them to just general activism, either at a very small level with a few friends or like a more established upstate or local group. Also, I just wanted to make sure that like this is discussion based. So if you have questions, just interrupt me at any point, or if you have points that you'd like to make. Like, I'm not an expert on the topic by any means. I just know maybe a little bit more because I've worked for a few campaigns. But if you have any points that you'd like to make, just interrupt me. And yeah, we can keep it as a discussion. So the reason why, the problem that I noticed working for campaigns, so last summer when I worked as a congressional campaign staffer, we actually worked with a lot of local campaigns because our campaign was not doing too badly in the district, but the local campaigns needed more help. So the part of the strategy was to focus on helping other, I work for Democratic campaigns, so helping other Democrats. By the way, this applies to either Democratic campaign, Republican campaigns, any kind of campaigns. So we noticed that the problem was that the local campaigns had a lot of trouble getting help. So my job was to recruit volunteers and work with volunteers. And we managed to recruit about 50 volunteers or 60 volunteers in the first week. They were a mixture of high schoolers and college students, but the local campaigns had a lot of trouble recruiting people, and most of the people who volunteer for them were older, just very few people who were just older. So the problem was that they were having trouble gaining traction and having volunteers, so we helped them and channeled a few of our volunteers to them. And I was just thinking about why that would be the case and what the problem was. Because if we're getting at so many people, it didn't make that much sense that they wouldn't be able to get people to. So, I saw that the problem was probably that one, higher level campaigns are more glamorous, or it's a nicer thing to put on your resume basically if you're a college student or in high school, saying that you're an intern for a congressional campaign as opposed to a state or municipal campaign. So that was part of the reason. Also, they are less talked about in the news. It's less people know about them basically. People don't really know what's happening. Few people actually know, people who are not living in the community or super involved in politics might not know who their state representative or their state senator or senators are. So people just don't know about it. Or people just feel like, younger people tend to feel like working for a presidential campaign or a congressional campaign or a senatorial campaign has more prestige attached to it. So they just prefer to do that. But at the same time, those local elections do matter. First of all, we see it now I know that the day of action is in response to what's happening politically. And we see that states have rights, first of all. So local campaigns do matter because there are actions that state can take to protect the rights of citizens or to help people with general things. For example, sanctuary cities are a big thing right now. And whether people agree with them or not, it's just one example of how states have some influence in the political system. A president or Congress might put out a law or something, right? And the states have a few means in their arsenal to fight it if they feel like it's really unfair or if they disagree completely. So it's not like the way the system is divided in the United States with federalism, it's not like the president controls everything, and states actually have a lot of rights. So it matters what happens at the state level, and it matters who's elected at the state level, almost just as much as it matters at the presidential level. And a lot of things actually happen or controlled by the state, right? For example, education, a lot of times is controlled by the state. So these things matter too. I mean, it starts at the schools, it starts at elementary school, and then you form citizens for the future. So even if that's one interest, that's a big thing too. So the states matter is basically what I'm saying. And the other side to that is that I know that in some instances when there are congressional campaigns, state leaders, community leaders, and also state elected community elected official, like state senators or state representative, can have some power or can have some sway, because a lot of time the congressional candidates or the senatorial candidate or the gubernatorial candidates for the seat of governorships and things like that count on them to deliver key constituencies. So because they work with very small groups or very small constituencies, a lot of time they have very strong attachment to those communities and those local places. And the congressional candidate might go to them and ask them, hey, can you endorse me so that your constituent will also vote for me? So at that point, it matters to them that they have at least some support from the local leaders. And I can say that it might be very hard for you to find a congressional candidate who has the support of no local leaders who actually wins an election at the congressional level. So it matters that way too. And I already talked about that actually. Why they're ignored? Because they're just not seen as prestigious, or because they have smaller budgets and they don't spend a lot of time on publicity, and a lot of people hear about them. They have very small staff. Sometimes it's a 1/2 person operation, so they don't really have a lot of resources to devise someone to go to high schools and talk to students and recruit them, or to send email to college professors or to college departments and recruit them. Whereas a congressional campaign could hire someone like me to do that. So that's part of the problem. So just in terms of incentives and why people should get involved, first, they matter. Second, I had structured this talk a little bit more towards college students, but I think this might apply here too to some people, is that there's opportunity for growth. Like, I started as an intern in a campaign, I ended up working as a staffer in a campaign, and I do want to continue some campaign work in the future. So even if the one motivation for someone to do that were just the prestige or just the professional growth, then there is opportunity there too. So it's not like this is just one, you'll get stuck as an intern forever. People all qualified. When I worked during the summer, one of those local campaigns were ran by a high schooler, a senior in high school. He was very energetic and very happy about it. But if a high schooler can run those campaigns, definitely college students can run them. And definitely people who've gone to college or gone to high school can run them too. So there are no specific sets required to be working in an election. I started as an intern with no skills at all. And it's a lot of learning. It's not a field where you can just go in and do anything and it will work. Like, you do have to put in the work and you do have to learn, and learn from people who've been in the field for a long time. But at the same time, you don't have to get a college degree in campaign work in order to be able to work in a campaign or even run a campaign. A lot of the work and learning is actually done on the ground while you're doing it, and you learn as you go. So people might feel like they're not qualified to run one or volunteer in one, and they definitely are. Also, in those campaigns, there are different levels of involvement that you can have based on how you feel qualified. Or what you think you can do. You can work as a volunteer. The distinction between volunteer and intern is usually the amount of time that they put in. So an intern is probably there every day for a few hours. A volunteer might come up once a week or once a month during the election season. So it just really depends on your time and your availability. And it doesn't have to be a full-time thing. I know that college students, especially at Princeton, tend to have internship and work and other things going on during the summer. But this is a thing where you can do it once a Saturday for 2 hours. And it actually provides them a lot of help if you do that. So it's not like you have to spend to give your life out to the campaign, unless you want to. And if you want to, you can be a full-time intern or a full-time staffer and literally live at the office. So your level of engagement depends entirely on your time, on your availability, and your desire. Also, there are a lot of skills that I feel like can be brought to the table. The campaigns will actually be becoming very technologically inclined. So they are using a lot of technology now. I know when I started interning, people would come to the office and make phone calls. Now, the last time I worked there, I went back doing fall break to work right before the election in November. And then now the campaign I worked for had a system where you could call from your house. So basically it's like you get in a dialer online, so you could just be at your house and you'd never be working on the same list as someone else or calling the same person, and your interests get registered from online and then it gets sent to the campaign. So there's a lot of, and I feel like there are a lot of skills here in the power conference and students learning in various fields, and there are a lot of there's a lot of knowledge that could be brought that could improve this, both as like technologically speaking, or in the sociology field, for example, if you have knowledge about like just sociology, knowledge in sociology could help with reaching out to constituents, knowledge in public policy, literally all kind of knowledge could come together in a campaign and make it more efficient and more effective. So what you know matters, and it might be a very specific or very obscure kind of knowledge, but it could still apply to the campaign. So you just have to put it to the test. And you can do it anywhere. So that was a thing, right? During the day, earlier this month, or well, not this month, last month now, they had a day of, they had a smaller day of action where they were calling congressmen and representatives and writing letters. And those things tend to be focused on people who live on the district. So if there's a district in a swing state but you don't live in it, you can't usually just contact, they will like ask you for your zip code, well you could, but they'll usually ask you for a zip code or some form of verification in order to get to the congressperson or the senator. But for campaigns, you can work anywhere. You don't have to be affiliated with a state. You don't have to be in the state. You can get up and go to Pennsylvania tomorrow and start working for a campaign. And you don't have to be a resident. I'm not a resident or a citizen of the U.S., and I've been working for campaigns for a really long time. So this is really important, because when we talk about swing states and swing districts, maybe that's where you might have more, your help might be needed more in those places, and you can do that if you want. It could be a state close to you, or it could be a state very far away from you, and you could move for a few months, or if you're already working in the states, that's the other thing, right? I know people here intern at various places a lot in the U.S., and chances are you'll be able to find a campaign where you're interning or working, and be able to give them a few hours of your time during the summer or during the week, depending on what you want. So it can happen anywhere. And the good thing with technology now is that you don't even have to go to the office in a lot of instances, or in some instances. So if you're in a new state and you don't want to go to their office, then you can do that. Or from the state where you are, you could be calling into another state. I know that we called into a lot of swing states from Connecticut as I was there. So you don't have to move to Ohio to make phone calls for Ohio, basically. So it's becoming easier, so there's no reason not to do it. A few tools. I know that those the elections at the local level are not as publicized, so very few people might not be able to know where they are and when they are happening and how to get involved. But actually, just in terms of general aggregate information, Ballotopedia actually has the calendar for local elections. And you can go there and find out where your, if there are elections going on during this year or this month or this cycle in your state, depending on where you are, and you can find out what level, who's running, etc. And even if the information is not as detailed, it could be just that there is an election in the 34th district in Ohio, then you could go into the Ohio State Secretary's page and find out who's running and what it is, or you can call in. So like, this is a good place to start, and then once you find out that information, you can go deeper into finding out who the candidates are, who you want to help, etc. The other place is USA.gov, also has general information about elections. You just go and be on the page and then you enter your state and then it'll tell you. And then again, the state secretary's pages are good places to look for election details. They often run elections in the state, so you just go on their pages or you enter like New Jersey State Secretary, and then usually you should be able to find something online. And then if you're someone who's not as technologically savvy and you prefer to speak to someone, you probably will find a phone number on their page and you can call them and ask them details about that election. I will skip article for a second. And then in terms of inventing tools, there's a big, I think, place now, or a big market for those kind of tools, for those kind of places where information can be, where you can find aggregate information and detailed information about elections. So maybe that's a challenge for Princeton. I know we have like FISA challenges and computer, I can't code, so I can't help. But I know they have a lot of challenges in the technological field here. And that might be something that you want to create or something that you want to help with. Maybe a very easy app for you to just access from your phone. People like accessing from their phone. So maybe looking in your phone and finding out who's running, where they're running, where the office is, how you can volunteer. That might be a good place to start. And then for other tools, I don't know. These are the tools that I can think of off the top of my head. But if there's anything else that you know and you want to propose now, that would be a good place to do it. I'll keep looking, and if anyone's still interested, and if I find anything else, I can have you email them out.
There was a tool that was talked about in the gerrymandering that's like just swingstate.org.com. So you find out, you know, your local swing states.
Yeah.
Way to get in, prioritize where to get involved.
Yeah.
Swing left.
Yeah. And that's also a very important thing because sometimes people want to work where they will make the most impact. And I mean, impact can be measured in different ways, but if you're thinking about, like, regardless of the party for which you work, if you're thinking about maximizing the amount of people in that party who occupy local and congressional and federal offices, then that might be a good place to start. Okay, so how to make an impact, or what you actually do when you work for these campaigns. There is a long list of things that you can do, and I'm sure that out of that list, there are probably other things that you could do that they haven't thought about yet, so you could propose some things that you could do. And if it's helpful, it would be hard for you to find a campaign that would say, no, don't do this, I don't want help. The main thing that the main things that happen at offices and congressional and local campaigns are really phone calls to constituents. And they can be annoying a little bit, but they can be fun too. And that's just part of the job, and that's just what has to be done. Like, a lot of work, a lot of impactful work is not necessarily glamorous, but it's important. I would, like, get into competition with interns back when I was in high school, and one of the interns would always come the shift after me and make one more call so he could win. So then I started, like, coming to two shifts. It was ridiculous, but it was also a way for me to make it fun, and, like, I like having, like, measurable things. That's just me. But you could just go and make a few phone calls, too. You could run a campaign, again, especially at the local level. It's the set of skills needed is less specialized than what you need for a congressional campaign, or the amount of experience that people want from you at the local level is less intense than what they would ask of you at the congressional level. So it would probably be harder for you to go to a congressman or an incumbent or someone running for congress and tell them, let me run your campaign. But if you go to a state senator or a state representative or council person, probably. So you could start there, and that also could be a good learning opportunity for you if you ever want to stay in the work and run presidential campaigns 4, 5, 10, 15 years down the line.
How much time is this? Like, when you worked over the summer as a staffer, like, was that like a full-time job or like a part-time thing? Or
For me, it was a full-time job. The campaign for which I, like, I've worked for campaigns at, like, different places. So I've worked for very tight races, and I've worked for less tight races, right? So definitely it was, the past campaign that I worked for was not as stressful, I would say, but then I would like to find other things that can make it fun to fill the time, like things to do with the interns. But it was a full-time job for me, but for the interns it was a part-time job. So they would come in a few days a week. And I also worked with volunteers would come in once every month or once every week, or closer to the election date every day. So it varies, but it was a full-time thing for me. And if you are a campaign manager, it's probably going to be a full-time thing for you. If you are an intern, it's probably not. So it depends. Canvassing is the equivalent of phone calls, but in person. I personally hate canvassing. I'm scared of dogs, so I don't like going to people's houses. But I know people who prefer canvassing over phone calls, so it's a matter of preference and it's what you like. Campaigns won't tell you that you have to canvass or you have to make phone calls. Like, they'll tell you maybe that we need more people to do canvasses, but if you only will do phone calls, then they will accommodate that and they will take your help. So it's a matter of what you prefer. Some people really love it. They think it's more fun. They go in a big group and then they distribute flyers and talk to people face to face. That's also an important part of campaigns. You could write letters, mostly to the editor of newspapers, letters saying why you support X or Y person, and maybe in general, or sometimes about a specific topic like the environment, energy, transportation, communication, etc. So that could be a way to do it, or you could email constituents. I haven't seen that done yet, but I'm sure there's a place for it. Or you could donate. I mean, if you don't want to donate time, which is a lot of what campaign work is, they always look for money. I mean, they need money for advertisement. Money is just part of campaigns, and they need money to run campaigns. So if you, and I know that, so thinking about the past election cycle, thinking about how much money Bernie raised just out of small donations, like every bit counts, especially for a local campaign where they don't need millions and millions of dollars, but they still need money to run. Food. People need food at the campaign offices. I actually spent an entire day buying food back in November, and I had to make like 5 more trips because I had so much food in my car. But when they host volunteers and interns, a lot of times they'll provide a little snack. It's not anything big, but they'll give them chips or water, things like that. So if you can donate that, and you prefer to donate that over money, you'll probably still take it too. Again, very little things that they would say no to. And sometimes it's a pizza night where they have volunteers over to make phone calls over pizza or in wine. So if you want to make the pizza and order wine, then you can do that too. So there are a lot of ways that you can get involved that don't involve you giving your time or being present at the office or having your face put on things. So, yeah.
What hours and days of the week were volunteers usually there?
Yeah, so for volunteers, for interns during the summer, it's usually during the day, but for volunteers, they make it purposefully in the afternoon, so it would usually be after your work shift. You could come during the day because there are usually people, staffers and interns at the office, so if you're free during the day or you're off during the summer, you could go during the day, but again, that would vary with campaigns, but from my experience, for volunteers, it's usually either the weekend or after work hours during the week. Because they want people to come, so it makes sense that they wouldn't schedule it right during the work shift. So, and since for phone calls and canvases, I mean, they try not to do it during dinner time, so they might have a later shift after, like, right before dinner, like after work, maybe 3 to 5 or something like that, and then they usually, like, try to keep the dinner time open. Like, you might be able, there are some that run during that time, but it's just harder to get people to either answer the phone or come to the door because we're having dinner. And then there might be a later shift between like 7 and 10, and usually 9 or 10 is a hard cutoff to start calling people's houses or going to people's houses. Yeah, but that's generally the time frame. Again, it might vary by 30 minutes or an hour depending on where you are. I don't know how early the sun sets. But usually that's the time frame. And I guess last note in terms of, and then I'll open it for questions or discussions. I've been talking for a while. Last note is that usually, or at least from my experience, there's often one person who runs a lot of elections in the state, especially at the local level, or is very well connected with people who run those smaller local campaigns. So if you can find that person, or you can find a point of reference or a point of contact, usually they'll be like able to direct you to how to go about volunteering or helping. But if you don't care specifically about a particular campaign and you just want to help X or Y party, then usually if you call the party, they have town committees and they have state parties. So if you call them, they'll be able to direct you to X, Y, and Z in your district or your county. So it depends, but usually finding a point of contact to be able to get that information is helpful. And usually once you call and if you find a point of contact, they will put you on a list. A lot of people say, remove me, but a few people come in and say, add me. Those are the golden people. Usually you'll get an email update about for that particular campaign or for all the campaigns, depending on the level at which you give your name. So if you give your name to a congressional campaign, you might be getting emails also from local campaigns based on that. But if you give your name to a local campaign, you might be getting those emails. And that's just about like when they are having events, what kind of events they are having, how you could help. And you can always be honest about your time, the amount of time you can give, or the amount of time you're willing to give, the amount of money you're willing to give. Again, they can use all the help that they get. So if you say I can only be there for, I have had people who told me that they can only be there for 15 minutes, and you still schedule them, you know, say no. And those 15 minutes might count because maybe during that 15-minute call shift, they reach out to someone who's a swing voter, who's not convinced yet. And especially at the local level, every vote counts because we're talking about very narrow margins. So again, 10, 5, 15 minutes, it helps. So if that's what you can give, that's good. And then vastly enjoy it. I've had a lot of fun doing fucking things. I mean, nowadays I feel like they're taking a more serious tone because of what happened in the past election. So everyone's like, ah, I can't mess up. But they're also really fun. Like, you get to meet a nice group of people who are also very, like, who have interests beyond the campaign, but it depends on what kind of conversations you want to have. You could talk about the campaign the entire day, or you could talk about random things. It's kind of like a college campus, honestly. A lot of interests converge. So it's a fun time. Especially, like, I personally like tight races, because then you can never slack off and you're always on your toes. But if it's not a tight race, it could also be really fun, because if you could have more time to be personable and not focus on the campaign. So it depends on what you're looking for as an experience, really. But yeah, that's my little presentation. Does anyone have any questions? Yes.
I guess I've never been interested in, like, volunteering for a campaign before, because I feel like the calls are, like,
mm-hmm.
like, you know, if I would get a call, I would, like, not want to engage
yeah.
with the person. So I thought that would be a waste of my time to do that, because, you know, 9 out of 10 people I call would just, like, hang up on me. Like,
mm-hmm.
how effective, like, are the calls? Like,
so,
or, like, how many people do you think, like,
mm-hmm.
it makes a difference?
See, yeah, that's a good question. I mean, I studied a verbatim column last time of, like, the mean things that get said. Some of them were really funny. People don't like receiving calls, right? Like, that's just, like, I don't like receiving calls, but I'm nicer to people now because I've done it. But it also depends. Some people will talk to you for 15 minutes on the phone. The majority of people won't pick up. That's just how it works. And then a few people will be mad. Usually if you get some, like, very few people will be outright rude about it. Very few. But the thing is, a lot of time, like, in terms of who gets mad more often, or who's, like, happy to take your call, people who are already voting for the candidate that you're supporting will most likely be nice about it, or be happy to take your call. So a lot of time, those specific calls to people who are already in your party are not as, like, they're not persuasion calls, they are reminder calls, because a lot of times someone might be a supporter but not have any intention to vote, and that phone call that you make could, like, remind them to go vote. And it's important, because if you support someone but you don't vote for them, pretty much doesn't matter. So I think that it depends on what kind of calls you are making. There are different kinds. There are, like, phone calls to partisans, to, like, supporters. There are persuasion calls. Those tend to be harder. There are people on the line. And those get recorded differently for different campaigns. But basically, over the years, they have accumulated the data, so they pretty much know if someone's a swing voter, if someone's a strong supporter, if someone is in your position, basically. So I would say that the calls that you make for the swing voters and your position are harder, especially for your position. No, like, not fine. But the calls that you make for supporters, they tend to be more pleasant, and they might feel less useful when you're doing them, because everyone's like, sure, I'll vote for him. But it's really good, because they serve as reminders that actually you need to get out of your house and vote. And then the other calls that get made later during the campaign, closer to election day or on election day, or reminder calls. So you call someone and you say, hi, I'm calling from X or Y campaign. I'm just telling you that your voting site is X. You can vote between these hours. Remember to go vote. Or, like, some of them are also calling college students who vote absentee a little bit before the election. And you call them and you're like, hi, how are you? Did you remember to send your ballot? It was funny because I was calling them and I feel like they thought I was someone, like, an older person, just remember to send your ballot, and they're like, I'm putting it in the mail right now as we're talking. So those are also important. So again, I feel it's a mixed response, right? And it depends on the group that you're tackling at the moment. Yeah.
But just to chime in on that, I did like the reminder calls for Bridgeport, actually.
Oh, really?
And, not overlapping with you, because I was living there probably before. And yeah, I definitely got multiple calls where the person was like, oh, right, yeah, I totally forgot that was where I was supposed to go, but thank you for telling me.
Yeah.
So you do get feedback that, like, it did make an impact.
Yeah. The other thing that some campaigns do, depending on their resources, is coordinate drivers and helpers for during the election day. So we would make phone calls to like older people and senior citizens and ask them, do you need a ride to the polls? And then coordinate with the drivers and volunteers within the campaign. So that's another thing that you can do if you don't want to work during the election cycle, but you have a car and you're happy to drive people and like have fun conversation with people in your car. It's like Uber but for elections and it's free. Maybe that's an app to be made, right? And then someone from the campaign will call you and tell you this person at X, Y house can you pick them up and drive them to the polls. And they're usually really grateful because of people who want to vote but can't get out, can't walk to the polls because it's not closed, don't have a car, or are physically impaired and can't make it. So it's very helpful to them.
I think Lyft actually was offering free rides or some sort of credit last for the election. But rides are really important. I think that it's really what you were saying, it just reinforces that it's not only about convincing the most stalwart opponent, it's about getting people to actually go out and vote because the voter turnout is such an important issue.
And I feel like there's a big opening because I think that turnout this is probably a different talk, but like turnout as an issue probably affects younger people more. And I feel like the best way to get to young people is by using young people. So me speaking to a friend about why they should vote today, or like me just being happy and peppy about it and telling them, let's go vote, it's probably more convincing than getting a call from a senior citizen in the middle of Connecticut telling them, did you vote today? I mean, maybe that's convincing too. But I feel like there's a lot of room for younger people to get involved in campaign work and to bring their skills and their enthusiasm and their youth into it.
Do they have trainings for all, like if you're doing a phone call or if you're going canvassing?
Of course, yeah, they do. I train a lot of interns, and sometimes interns train interns if they've been doing it for long enough. Before you start making a phone call, first phone calls and canvassing usually come with scripts, so you're not just improvising, right? They give you talking points and they give you a script, so it's basically, hi, my name is X, I'm calling from the X campaign, may I speak to X? I was just calling to ask XYZ. Right? They give you a script and then they make mock phone calls with you before you start. And then for canvassing also, they like do a little theater skit about what could happen at the door. And especially for canvassing, a lot of campaigns are the ones I've worked for have safety procedures. So they never let you go alone and they don't let you go past a certain time and you never enter the person's house, etc., etc. So you'll definitely find guidance. They won't just like give you a phone and tell you to make phone calls. And I've also, while I was writing the presentation, I was looking up just this political campaign running. Like, I was putting in a lot of words into Google, and there are quite a few. I know there are definitely books on the subject, but if you were interested in running a campaign, there are also quite a few resources online that could help you, especially at the local level, because, again, those matter, and that's what tend to do them. It's probably going to be harder for you to run the presidential campaign next year, but you can run it. And reminder that 2018 is a mid-year election time, so a lot of Congress people will be up for election, and at the local level, there will also be like state legislatures that will have seats open during that time, and in the off years also, like in 2017, there are quite a few elections going on in a few states. So if you happen to be in those states and you want to stop by and give some help, regardless of what that means, time, money, food, then you can do that.
What is the relationship between the like a campaign and the local party, like whether it's like the county party or the municipal committee? Or...
You mean like their party affiliation, like the Democratic or the Republican?
No. Does the local party, like infrastructure, have any kind of, do they provide support? Or like if I wanted to volunteer for the local party, would I ever be like, say, would they ever say like, oh, go work on this campaign for...
Oh, yeah. So you mean like, so I refer to the Democratic Party, so I'll just use that as an example. But if I said the town committee, like a lot of towns have their own committees, so it's like a breakdown of the Democratic Party has like the state level and has a town, has the general like town level. So each town has a little group that's part of the state party, basically. So if you call into their office, usually they like provide help to all the campaigns in the town. And usually the same people who run the local party will be the one volunteering, so they need help outside of that. It's a lot of merging. And the people actually, the difference between the local campaign and the local party though is that the local party would also make the calls for the presidential candidates and the congressional. So they make calls for all of them, whereas a local campaign tends to focus on the local campaign. But if you, the higher you go up the ladder, the more you provide help to the lower levels usually. So if you're working for a congressional campaign, you'll likely be making phone calls for the local campaigns too, or like asking about the local candidates also. But if you're working for a local campaign, you might tend to focus on just that candidate because you don't have as many resources to dive into. So, yeah.
Any other questions?
Do you have a campaign you? You mentioned that you wanted to work on campaigns again in the future.
Yeah, I do.
Do you have one that you want
to? So I really like the campaign I worked for, but I'm also open to other things because the district where I work, or the campaign for which I work usually, it's like a pretty democratic place. So it makes an impact, but I feel like it'd be fun to work in the swing states, maybe once.
Absolutely.
The other thing is, and that's just for the ladies in the room, sorry, but there is a Yale campaign school for women. I actually wanted to go this year, but it's during graduation. So I don't know yet that I want to go, but maybe not if my mom gets her way. So yeah, so if you are interested in that, you can Google it. I think it happens every at the beginning of June all the time, and I'm sure they're probably expanding now, so. If you're interested in that, it's like a 1 week boot camp like training session
for working in campaigns?
Yes, for women. It's a Yale women's campaign program or campaign school. If you enter a combination of those words in Google, you'll find it. That's also fun. And I'm sure you can get training in various ways, including by reading on your own or by just working in a campaign. And just to tie in, this applies for local activism of any kind, right? Even if it's a small group working on energy issues or working on reproductive rights issues, whatever it is, like I feel like everyone needs help at this point. So the same principles of like giving in your time, your money, your energy, your food, etc., that could apply to them too. So if you want to be less political, if you prefer to be focused on one issue as opposed to a whole spectrum of them, then I'm sure you'll find a local chapter of X, Y, or Z kind of movement. Be able to provide your time or money to them too at the local level. Yeah.
Do you ever want to run for office?
Oh, I can't run in the U.S. At least not yet because I'm not a citizen. And probably not for a really long time. I really enjoy campaigns. Like I really enjoy the campaign side of things. So I don't know. I mean, I wouldn't rule it out forever, but right now I'm leaning more no than yes. I don't know, I really enjoy being behind the scene and like running campaign errands. I feel like there is probably less pressure associated with that than we can do too. So, and less scrutiny, like you can do your thing in the background and celebrate at the end. And then the work starts for the people once they get elected and goes in. That's the other thing, I mean, that's the other thing, campaign work is very temporary, so it's a good thing to do if you don't want to be involved all the time, or if you want to be involved all the time. It's different if you want to be involved all the time, because then you always have to be looking for work at the end of the cycle, basically. But it also means that because they're temporary, it means that you don't have to be to always be there in order to be involved. Like it's nice because I could like work this summer, but not the past one, and do something different. If that's not what you want to do all the time, it's not like you get out of the loop for a long time if you don't work for a year, because usually the cycle is 3 years or 4 years, depending on what you're doing. So it's nice because there is not that constant need for you to be there or for continuity in order for you to like be working with them or be effective. You get a nice little break, which is not necessarily good if you just want to do campaigns, because then you're in a break and it's like, I need work. Any other questions? Well, thank you.